सर, विजिबल सर।
फाइन, okay, so it's almost 1:05, so I'm starting the class. So as you know that yesterday I discussed how to start the induction motor, okay, the working principle of the three-phase induction motor. So today we will learn the torque equation, the concept of slip. I already told you the basic concept of slip, right? So today the brief In brief, we will learn the slip, the torque in the induction motor, okay, starting torque, torque under running condition, and the very important is the torque speed curve. Sometimes this question was given in exam of 3 marks, okay, of 3 marks. Next one is the power stages in an induction motor. That means you are giving one input, okay, and after several steps you are getting the output from the shaft, okay. So what are the stages? Okay, that will be discussed here. Next, the starting of the induction motor. Since you know that total two types of induction motors are there, okay, total two types of induction motors are there, induction motor, total two types, okay. One is squirrel cage, or just a minute. Okay, so total two types of induction motor. One is squirrel cage, right? Another one is wound rotor, WOUND, wound rotor, or it is also known as the slip ring. Okay, so total two types of induction motors are there, and how can we start it? What are the possible methods of starting? That will be discussed in this section. Okay, so first, what is slip? I told you that the rotation of the stator magnetic field, that is the maximum amount of speed with which the rotor can rotate, right? But if that speed is attained by the rotor, then what will happen? Their relative velocity will be zero. Then the development of the voltage and, as usual, the current will be zero. So it will not rotate at all. Okay. So that's why the speed of the induction motor remains always less than the original synchronous speed. Okay. This NS is called the synchronous speed. Okay, how can I calculate? Its formula is 120 F by P. Okay, what is P? P is the number of pole. What is F? That is the frequency of the magnetic field. Right? Now, next, then what is the slip? The difference between the synchronous speed and the rotor speed, that is called basically slip. Okay, I already told you one example, that if suppose the value of P is 6, okay, your frequency is 50. So what is your NS value? Your NS value, or you can say the synchronous speed, will be 120 into 50 by 6. So that will be almost 1000 RPM. Right? So that is 1000 RPM. But you are observing that the rotor speed, that NR or N, whatever you want to say, that the machine, the output shaft is rotating with a speed of 900 RPM. Okay, so there is a difference between these two, right? So that difference, calculate 100 divided by NS into 100%. So that will give you the percentage of slip. That means how much percent? 10%. Okay, so your slip amount is 10%. So that's how we can calculate the slip. Okay, now based on this slip, the rotor EMF we can also calculate. Right, in that stator, in this stator, the EMF given, suppose, is E1, and at the front position of the rotor, the EMF generated is E2. After induction, this was generated, right? But due to the slip, what is your output EMF? That EMF is S into E2. From the rotor, the EMF we can get is S into E2, right? Similarly, what is the frequency of the rotor magnetic field? That frequency of the rotor is S into F. Okay, so that's why this slip is very important, because without calculation of this slip, you cannot generate, you cannot estimate what is the voltage, what is the output EMF. Okay, now this slip at full load is about 4 to 5% for small motors and 2 to 2.5% for the large motors, right? Now the slip at no load is about 1%, so that means it is very less. Okay, next, here you can see how you will get this F dash. F dash means your frequency at the rotor. Okay, the frequency of the rotor current is almost always same, but the voltage and the frequency, this frequency of the rotor is always different. Right, how can you calculate this one? This is S into F. From here, you can get that value. Okay. Now, this S into NS, if you calculate, that means your 100 RPM. Okay. That 100 RPM, that is called the slip speed. 1000 RPM is your synchronous speed. Okay, that is your synchronous speed. Next, 900 RPM is your rotor speed. That is, I am writing it as NS, synchronous speed. This, I am writing this one as N. So what is your slip speed? S into NS. The slip speed is 100 RPM. Okay. So that is the total description of the slip and how and why do we need it. Okay. Is that clear to you? Is this slip concept clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, next we will develop the torque equation. Okay, this one is not that much important, but they gave 8 to 10 marks numerical. Okay, sometimes they gave this numerical based on the torque of the induction motor. Okay, so how can I create that torque equation? EMF value we know, the current value we know, and the angle between the voltage and current, that we also know. Okay, so from that values, how can I calculate? Right, now look, in case of DC motor, what is known to us? That the flux and the current, this one, these two values are very important. Okay, flux denotes the phi. The flux is denoted by the letter phi, and IM means your armature current. Okay, in case of this induction motor, it is seen that the torque is always proportional to phi. That means if you increase the flux, your torque will again increase with proportionality. Okay. Similarly, if you increase the current, if you increase the current, you will see that the current, that the torque is also increasing. Okay. So if you combine these two, you can generate the torque TA is directly proportional to phi into IA. Okay, now this phi is also proportional to the EMF. Okay, also proportional to the EMF of the rotor. Clear? Here, look, this flux, this EMF is also directly proportional to the EMF. EMF is directly proportional to the flux. Right? So, from here, I can say that torque is directly proportional to the E2, okay, I2 into cos theta 2, whereas this theta 2 is the angle between the voltage and the current, or you can say EMF and the current, right? Now, if you remove this proportionality value, suppose there will be a small constant K into E2, all these terms will come down. Okay, now what is E2? Suppose the rotor is not rotating, it is at the standstill point. Then what can I say? Then at standstill point, there will be no slip. Okay, at standstill point, your slip is totally 1. Okay, so at that point, what will be your rotor EMF? Rotor EMF will be simply E2. Okay, so that's why we are writing E2 only. Now, if it is not standstill, if we are considering that this induction motor is rotating with slip S, okay, then this simple equation will be converted into T directly proportional to S into E2 into I2 into cos theta 2. okay, it will be changed if we consider the running condition. This is the standstill condition. That means the rotor is not rotating at all or on the verge of rotating. Clear? This one is at the running condition. This one is called the running condition. Okay, so this is the equation of the torque in case of induction motor. Now it is developed, it is seen by experiment that this K value equals to the 3/2 pi ns. The K value equals to 3/2 pi ns. Okay, so ns value if you know, then you can calculate the value of K. Okay, now what is starting torque? How can I know? This equation is known to you, that TST equals to K into E2 I2 into cos theta 2 or cos phi 2, whatever you want to say. Okay. Now, here, what is I2? I2 equals to E2 by Z2, right? So, what is the value of Z2? That is the combination of rotor resistance and reactance. So from here I am getting that I2 equals to E2 divided by root under of R square plus Z square. Similarly, from the impedance triangle, calculate the value of cos phi 2, or you can say cos theta 2. That's up to you. Okay. So if you know the impedance triangle, this is your impedance triangle, that is R. Okay, this is your X, L. Okay, what is your Z? This is your Z. Okay, this value is your Z. This is also your XL. What is this angle? This is your phi 2, or you can write here as theta 2 also. Okay, as you want. So from here, I2 value is known, cos phi 2 value is also known. Clear? So put all those values into this equation. So you will see that the starting torque equals to K into E2 square into R2 divided by R2 square plus X2 square. So this value you need to remember. Okay, so this value you need to remember, that is the starting torque. Now what will happen in case of running condition? In case of running condition, only the E2 value and the inductance value will change. Because what is this X? At running condition, okay, the starting condition is written here. See, the K value is known to you, that is the 3/2 pi ns, as I described. Okay, now look, torque under running condition. So in that running condition, what can I say? That this voltage will be changed as SE2, that EMF will change, right? And what did I tell you? The EMF will change, EMF change, and the frequency change when it is running. Okay, so EMF becomes S into E2 and the frequency becomes S into F. Okay, so if frequency changes, if the rotor frequency changes, then the inductance will also change. Because what is the value of inductance? X2, 2 pi F into L, right? So when the machine is running, then this frequency will change. Okay, so at running condition, this situation will become change, and the updated value will be 2 pi s into f into l, because instead of f we will write s into f. Okay, so suppose this one is xr. Okay, that means, or you can write this one as x2 dash. Okay, so this xr becomes s into x2, right? So now put all those values. So only what will change? The rotor EMF will change and the reactance will change only, right? So at the time of starting, what equation I know? K1 into E2 square R2 divided by, at the time of starting, right, divided by R2 square plus X2 square. So now during the running condition, what changes can occur at the time of running? Okay, at the time of running, what will happen? The E2 value will change to S into E2, right? So I am writing here K1 S into E2 whole square, okay, into R2, because resistance won't change. Only what will change again? R2 square plus S into X2 square. Why? Because the slip is now present, and due to the change of frequency, this reactance, the X2 value will change, right? So after that, you will get this equation. Check. Okay, you will get this equation, right? Okay, there will be only one S into E2, because there will be only S into E2 into E2. Okay, there will be only one S, because look, there is only one phi, right? So that's why this, there will be only one S. Okay, so this is your ultimate equation, T equals to 3 divided by 2 pi ns into S into E2 square into R2 divided by R2 square plus SX2 square. So this equation is enough for you. Okay, this equation is enough. Now, this is very important, the relation between the torque slip characteristic. Okay, this is very important. See, when the system, when the induction machine is zero, when the induction machine's rotation is zero, that means this point, okay, when the induction machine is zero, then it is starting from this, okay, and then it reached a particular value. This torque is called the maximum torque level. Okay, this torque level is called the maximum torque level. This slip is from 0 to 1. Why? Because when it is at standstill position, slip is 1. Okay, now here, look, this is your equation, torque. Okay, torque equals to K into phi into S into E2 into R2 divided by R2 square plus X2 square. Because look here, this is your equation. Okay, now here this flux is constant. Okay, so when this S equals to 0, then what will happen? if the value, it is clear that when s equals to 0, torque is also 0. If you put here s, the small s, slip is 0, then torque is also 0. Check this point. Here, slip is 0, the torque is also 0. Right? Now, at normal speed, when it is close to synchronism, the term Sx2 is very small, because at this point, the slip value is also very small. Okay? So, the change in Sx2, this value of the Sx2, this reactance value is also so small. Okay? That's why we can neglect this Sx2 part. Okay, why are we neglecting? Listen again. I am again repeating. Okay, let me erase this part. Okay, check this point. When torque is 0, at slip equals to 0. Right. Now suppose at this point, suppose your S value is very less. Okay, that is almost 0.05. So if your S value is so less, then what will be your frequency value of the rotor? That is also less. So if that frequency value of the rotor is less, then this reactance of the rotor will be also less, because frequency is less, that means reactance value will be less. Correct. So that we can nullify, we can neglect this Sx2 value. Then you will see that this total torque at that moment will be like this. K phi S E2 R2 divided by R2 square. Okay, so what will happen now? R2, the square term will cancel out. Okay, now then K, phi and E2, they are constant. So I can say that torque is directly proportional to S by R2. Now the resistance I cannot change. So I can say here torque is directly proportional to S. So that is nothing but a straight line equation. Okay, when I am saying that y is directly proportional to x, that means what? It is a straight line, right? Here, torque is directly proportional to s of the slip value. So, up to the maximum torque, look the propagation of the waveform. It is the straight line. Okay, now next case. The next case, when this maximum torque is, we are getting the more than the maximum torque, or we can say the breakdown torque. Okay, so at that point we will see that your frequency value of the rotor becomes so higher, because your slip value will become higher at this point. At this point your slip value is higher with respect to the previous one. Okay, so at that time the Sx2 value will be higher than the R2 value. Okay, then you will get this equation, torque directly proportional to 1 by S, or you can say inversely proportional to S. Okay, that means it is the hyperbolic equation. Okay, what I am saying, that is already written here. See, the R2 becomes negligible with compared to the X, S into X2, because at this point the slip value is higher. So ultimately the total value becomes higher than R2. So at that point, the total curve, the torque slip characteristics become hyperbolic in nature. Look here, the waveform is hyperbolic in nature, and it is different. It is different if the inbuilt resistance is changing. Okay, and this resistance can be changed using only the construction. Okay, only if you change the construction, you can change this resistance. Otherwise, you cannot. Okay, so that's how the maximum torque level is always same, but the torque speed characteristic up to a particular point, up to the maximum torque from zero point, is linear, and then it is hyperbolic in nature. Okay, see, the torque slip curve is rectangular hyperbola. Okay, next, this is the torque speed curve. Okay, this one is suppose the full load. This is suppose the full load speed. This is your breakdown torque, already I discussed, right? And this one is the locked rotor torque. That means at this point, you cannot generate more than torque. It is the maximum at this point. At this rotational speed, zero. Okay, this is the locked rotor torque, or you can say the stalling torque, stalling. Stalling, stalling torque. Okay, next, the power stages. What is the meaning of power stage? This is your stator part. This is your three-phase supply. Okay, red phase. This is your yellow phase. This is your blue phase. Okay, so I am giving the three-phase supply here. Active power input, right? Suppose this active power is your 10 kilowatt. Okay, I am saying active power. So active power's unit is kilowatt. Okay, now in that stator there is also copper coil wound, right? So a particular stator copper loss will happen. This is the stator copper loss. Okay, next, due to this construction there will be also iron loss because poles are there. Okay, so iron loss means there are two types, it is consisted of two kinds of loss. What are those? One is hysteresis loss, another one is eddy current loss. Okay, so suppose this stator copper loss is 1 kilowatt.
Sir, class is freezed.
Yes, sir.
Class khatam ho gaya kya?
Nahi sir, network loss ho gaya.
अच्छा, नेटवर्क का शटर डाउन है.
शटर नहीं भाई, सर्वर.
अरे अटेंडेंस है कि कोई फायदा ही नहीं है सर, है ही नहीं तो.
दिस हैपेंस व्हेन यू आर यू यूजर.
भी नहीं करेगा.
हाँ सर, जब आएंगे तब
जो नहीं करेगा.
अरे सर को तो थोड़ी करेगा,
नहीं करेगा.
हाँ वो
अटेंडेंस फिर से देना सर.
सर का अटेंडेंस क्लियर हो गया होगा
क्या?
नेटवर्क क्लियर हो गया.
Oh, so sorry, I was just disconnected. Just a minute.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so where was I? Yes, the 10 kilowatt is your total input, 1 kilowatt is your stator copper loss, and 1 kilowatt is your iron loss. So, in this rotor, what is your input power after the loss? That is 8 kilowatt. Okay, that is your rotor input. So, this is 8 kilowatt is your P2. Okay, this 10 kilowatt is your P1. Right. Now, the rotor winding, there is also copper. So, when the current flows, there will be copper loss also. Suppose that copper loss is 1.5 kilowatt. So, ultimately, the gross mechanical power that you have from the shaft, that amount is 6.5 kilowatt. Okay, just exclude this rotor copper loss. Okay. So, here 6.5 kilowatt is your mechanical power output. Next one is the windage and friction loss. What is this friction loss? That this shaft is rotating. Okay. Now, due to that rotation, what is your friction? That friction loss is suppose 0.5 kilowatt. Okay. So the output, what is your ultimate power that you can use, that amount is your 6 kilowatt. Okay, from the shaft, we are getting only 6 kilowatt. Right, so what is our total efficiency then? What is our efficiency? Efficiency means it is the ratio of output to input. Right. It is the ratio of output to input. So, what is your output? That is 6 kilowatt. What is your input? That is 10 kilowatt. That means your efficiency is 60%. Okay. Agar ye 60% hua, tum logo ka efficiency, to ye induction motor kabhi mat use karo. Ye sabse kharab induction motor hai. Okay. Induction motor ka agar efficiency itna kam hai, that means the loss is very big. Okay, that's why you are getting this small efficiency. In this year, that means in the thermal power plant or hydro power plant, whatever induction motors they use, on an average, their efficiency is more than 85%. Okay. Otherwise, what will happen? You will send the power, the maximum amount of power will be wasted. So, you will get very few amount of power from the shaft. So, that's not what we wanted. Right. So, our main motto is to reduce the copper loss mainly. Okay. Because iron loss we cannot change. Right. Iron loss we cannot change, we can change the quality of the copper so that the total copper loss becomes reduced. Right. So, this is the power stage of the induction motor. That's how with step by step you are getting the output power. So, this is the line diagram. Okay. So, see here, it is the motor input. This is the stator copper loss and the rest amount of power received in the rotor input power. It is also called the air gap power. Okay. Next, there is rotor copper loss. So, the rest amount of power is your gross rotor output or the mechanical power developed. If you exclude the windage loss from there, or friction loss, you will get the rotor final output. Okay. So, that's the main objective here. Next is the starting of the induction motor. So, I already told you that there are two types of induction motor we normally use. One is spiral cage, which is rubbed, right? And it is heavier. And it is cheap also. Okay. Next one is the slip ring rotor. स्लिप रिंग इंडक्शन मोटर. सो स्क्विरल केज इंडक्शन मोटर कैन बी स्टार्टेड यूजिंग द प्राइमरी रेजिस्टर, नेक्स्ट ऑटो ट्रांसफॉर्मर, देन द स्टार डेल्टा स्विचेस. ओके, नेक्स्ट इज द स्लिप रिंग मोटर्स. इट कैन ओनली बी controlled using this rotor rheostat. That means external resistance we can add, we can change in this slip ring motor, because there are provisions, there are points where we can add we can attach this rotor rheostat, but in case of squirrel cage we cannot add. Okay, so we only change the primary resistors, that means the from the stator point of view. Okay, all these changes can be done from the stator. Okay, and in case of slip ring motor, the speed can be changed or the starting can be done using the rotor rheostat from the rotor terminal. Okay, so first one is the primary resistor. See here, this is your primary stator part. Okay, now these stators are connected in series with external rheostat, right? So if your resistance is high, the total current input in that stator will low, right? So based using that concept, the speed can be changed. Next one is the auto transformer. Same condition, using that tapping system. Okay, I already told you that in auto transformer there is only one coil in primary and a some part of the total coil is used in the secondary. Okay, right, so if you use the tapping here, so if you slide it, then gradually the total current in the secondary will increase, and if the current increases, the torque also increases. Okay, so why don't we use the full load current at the first? Why do we use that starting torque, use these resistors? We use these resistors because if we use the full load current at the starting, there is a chance of burning the coil. Okay, so that's why for the safety purpose we gradually increase the current. Okay, we gradually increase the current from 0 ampere, 1 ampere, 2 ampere, 2.5, 2.75, 3, 3.5, 3.75, like this. Okay, now using that tapping it is only possible for auto transformer. Okay, next is also star delta starter. Okay, during the starting the connection is done in star formation, and while running the connection becomes changed to delta. Okay, why? Because in star condition you know that V phase equals to V line by root 3, right? So the voltage becomes less, the applied voltage becomes less, right? And while running we do the star delta connection. Why? Because at that time V phase becomes equal to V line. Okay, so just the voltage becomes root 3 times higher. So if your voltage is higher, your resistance is constant, so your total current will increase. Look here. Okay, clear? And in exam it can be given as only the short note of 5 marks. Okay, what are the starting procedures of the induction motor of maximum 5 marks? Right. Next one, start delta starter is okay. Starting of the slip ring motor. Now in this slip ring, that means the rotor portion across that slip ring, this rheostat is added. ओके एंड एज वी चेंज द रियोस्टैट वैल्यू यू कैन सी द टैपिंग्स ओके इफ वी चेंज द टोटल करंट फ्लो थ्रू द रोटर विल चेंज ग्रेजुअली ओके दैट इज रिटन हियर लुक These motors are practically always started with the full line voltage applied across the stator terminal because see the stator terminal from the stator terminal there is no provision to add the external resistance okay so that's why from the slip ring portion we add the external rheostat in the rotor part okay so As the resistance gradually cut out of the rotor circuit, that means when the resistance becomes lower, the motor gradually catches up the speed, the rotor speed. Okay, so that is the starting of the slip ring motor. So with this, the induction motor part is completed. So in next class. These will be learned. Okay, these will be discussed. The single phase induction motor. Okay, so thank you everyone for attending the class. All of you give your attendance in the chat box.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, and all of these materials up to 4.5 was already uploaded in the Google Classroom, so you can check there. Okay, and there is another numerical based PPT I prepared. Okay, where DC numerical and the AC and the induction machines numerical were written. Okay, and with the answers. So I won't discuss that here. I will upload that. If you have any kind of problem, you can ask me. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.